welcome to our next edition of the Tricom Unleashed Podcast. Today with me is Shelly Wilkinson, our Director of Sales with Tricom, and she's here to speak with me again about our Leadership 101 book that we have been talking about. This book is on leadership by John Maxwell, and we're going to take some questions today and talk about some of our favorite topics in the book.
Yeah. Good morning. I'm excited to continue our conversation from last time. This was, even though it was a short book, it was probably one of my all-time favorites because I feel like there was just so much to take away from this. And I mean, I think you and I are both the same. When we read, we take a lot of notes. And for me, I had pages and pages because there was just so much that I wanted to remember and kind of come back and talk about. So I'm anxious to get started. Where do you want to pick up from where we left off last time?
Sure. Yeah, I couldn't agree more. Love this book. So much valuable information packed into this 100-page book. Today, we're going to start by talking about influence. Why is influence important? So, Shelly, if you want to talk a little bit about why you think influence is important.
Yeah, you know, and again, it was... Of all of the information that I have taken from this little power pack book, the one thing that keeps resonating with me is that every one of us throughout our lifetime will influence at least 10,000 people. And the more I read this and reread this, I understand what that means and I understand the impact. And what it meant to me is that you can influence other people's lives and their success and their confidence and where they go in their career and in their personal lives. And it's not always purposeful. What I thought was really interesting is that he referenced Princess Diana and Mother Teresa. And I don't think that either of them set out in their lives to intentionally be influencers. And I know that term influencers probably means a lot to a lot of different people, especially given our social media and everything.
And it does.
But just seeing, you know, the wave of impact that both of them had because of their positions. And it wasn't necessarily that they had a chairman of the board or a CEO title in a company, but they chose to impact and affect others' lives because of things that they were passionate about and really wanted to help people see the best in themselves and bring out the best in others around them. And I'm curious hear your thoughts, Amanda, on kind of like what you thought about him bringing those two people into the discussion and what their impact and influence was.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, they talk about influence and that the measure of a leader is really their ability to influence others. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was just a really great characteristic that we should really be thinking about as leaders. That it isn't those everyday things that we're doing, which really fall under management, that really impact people. It's our ability to influence them and their ability to take that and become something great within themselves, that they can empower themselves to do other things because they have been influenced by somebody that saw value in them. And it's amazing to kind of see where that can take things. In the discussion about Diana, I mean, she is a legend. So yeah. Princess Diana, whether she lost her princess title or not, she didn't lose her influence. That it didn't have anything to do with position. It was far beyond that. And people just really followed her. They believed in her. There were a lot of characteristics that she displayed that people wanted to follow. So I think it's really important aspect of what leadership is. It's really based on the influence. And in John's book, he talks about some of the myths about leadership. So I want to talk about a couple of the myths because I thought that they were really good and kind of hear what your thoughts are. So the first one is the management myth. Tell me what you think about that.
I thought that that was so enlightening, because when you get into a management role, you think that automatically you have the capability of like moving people just because you have a title. And when I say moving people, I mean like getting them to develop and be better. And and nothing could be further from the truth. As you just talked about, Princess Diana, Mother Teresa, they did not have any sort of management title. They weren't part of any company or corporate environment. Yet their wave of influence was reached around the globe. Mm-hmm. So when I look at, okay, yes, I'm very fortunate. I have a leadership role and title, but that does not come with influence. That is affected by what we do with our people to, as you said, empower them to reach the goals that they have and develop as professionals and people. That's how you gain that influence. Your title has zero to do with it. So I felt that that was really, really interesting.
It is. And that's just the beginning. That's where we start. This is management level is where you, most people feel like they have the opportunity to mm-hmm. begin the influencing, to begin this journey that they're going to partake on. And that title, that responsibility is just the beginning. But you're really just focusing on process mm-hmm. and helping people manage a process, getting things done, which is not influence. So that's myth number one, which I think is a good one to make sure that we're talking about. And I'm not going to cover all five, but I figured I'd talk about a couple that I thought were really impactful. Myth number three that they talk about was knowledge, the yeah. knowledge myth.
Yep.
And many times people get into a leadership role because of their knowledge. Mm-hmm. They were given the opportunity to take over a department because they have the knowledge and the skills that they need to be successful. But then you have to take that and get the work done through other people. So it's bigger than just knowledge. And one of the things I thought was interesting was it has nothing to do with your IQ. So I found that interesting because it is not about being smart. You can be very, very smart and you mm-hmm. can be really great at what you do and have more knowledge than anybody. But that does not mean that you're going to be a good leader, that those two things are not one and the same, and that you need to have more than just knowledge to really be a good leader.
Yeah, I really... This was just so insightful for me on so many levels. I loved how he broke all of these myths down. And he referenced in there how you always hear knowledge is power, but that, to your point, is absolutely not the case. And the thing that I like that you mentioned is yes, you know how to do all of these things, but if you're not imparting that knowledge to the people around you, to the people that are on your team that you lead, and you seem to be the keeper of the kingdom and you're the only one that knows all of this information, that is definitely not an influencer. That's definitely not, in my eyes, even a leader. To me, then that means that you're operating under an umbrella of almost fear or insecurity. And I know my team kind of laughs at me, but I always tell them, I always want them to know what I know, because I don't want to be the only one, because people get sick, people go on vacation, things happen. And the last thing that I would ever want to do is leave my team in a position of, oh my gosh, Shelly is gone and we don't know what to do. I would never want to leave them in a position where they feel crippled and not empowered and capable to handle what they need to do in my absence. To me, that is a sign of a really good leader, when you have worked with your people and they kind of know what you're going to say when they come to talk to you. And I love it when someone from my team comes in and says, hey, I want to bounce something off of you. I'm pretty sure I know what you're going to tell me, but I just want to make sure that we're aligned. That's usually how the conversation goes. We usually are on the same page. If not, it's not so far off that I'm thinking, oh my gosh, where did this come from? But I see the confidence that that builds in them, and that they walk out of here feeling a little bit more sturdy in their decision-making and their interpretations of working with prospects. And that to me is fulfilling. I love to see that. I really appreciate that he kind of pulled that together and articulated that better than what I realized that that was something that meant to me. So I don't know how you feel about that, but I loved it. I thought it was great.
What I loved about what your thoughts on that were are related to the word fear. And I think so often that when people have a title and knowledge, they do become fearful of sharing that information because it might uproot them somehow, maybe degrade their value in their opinion because they're basing their value on knowledge. And knowledge is not really where you need to be focusing your energy. It's about bringing up others around you and behind you and making a really strong, solid team, a strong company, a strong culture. And people are not going to want to follow you if they sense that fear or that protection of yourself and not focusing on them. So I think that's a really big component of effective leadership and influence.
Yeah, and I know that these are some things, and it's a little off topic, but we've talked about as a team here, as a management team, on making sure that we are working with the people that are reporting to us and understanding what's really important to them. And for me, I can tell you in years past, I mean, early in my career, I was not comfortable admitting that I wasn't good at something. And delegating that out to somebody on my team, because to me, it felt like a weakness. And I remember, and I think you and I have even had this conversation where early on, I used to say, hey, I'm going to be on vacation, but I'm available. Call me if you need me. And that implies that number one, I haven't trained them well enough to be able to operate in my absence. And number two, I felt like once I sat back and looked at it, I'm sending them a message that you can't function if I'm not here. And nothing could be further from the truth. So now it's, I go on vacation and I tell them, hey, I'll see you when I get back. You guys are going to do great. If you're not sure about something, talk about it. There's other, you know, managers here if you're not sure, but I know you guys got this. There's never a problem when I'm gone. And when I see the confidence, you can just physically like see, you know, they walk a little different, they carry themselves a little differently, they trust themselves. And it also takes a ton of pressure off of us when we get to that point as leaders and say, yeah, I'm going to delegate this to you. You've got this. I've trained you well. You're smart. You're going to ask good questions. It just goes well all the way around. And again, I keep coming back to that. Okay, now I understand. Because I said, I don't know 10,000 people. How on earth am I going to influence 10,000 people? But this is how you do it. And kind of jumping ahead into one of the discussion points is when you influence someone on your team, that influence has a ripple effect because you're now influencing any and everyone that your team comes into contact with because they carry that forward. And it's just, then it made sense. If, I mean, honestly, anybody listening to that is going to think, yeah, I don't know why you didn't get that. But the light bulb came on and I thought, okay, now I understand. Now I understand the magnitude of the influence. I get it.
Yeah. And it's important to understand your weaknesses and to build yourself a team that complements all of those different weaknesses. So that's what makes really a strong team strong and where people are dependent on each other and they trust each other. And you have to have that trust that you can share that weakness with them And they're going to help make everybody stronger because of it. And that mm-hmm. you have that trust in them that they're going to take it and make it great, as opposed to using it against you as a weakness. Right. So it's really important to have an awareness of your weaknesses and then trust other people to help you with that and put people in positions to do things that they might be more capable of, or, you know, their skill set is really perfect for that, and being mm-hmm. okay with letting the whole team shine and not having everything rely on you.
Right.
And I think that's something that comes with some experience too. I think initially it's when you first get that position, you're trying to hold that authority, that title, and that kind of figure. Mm-hmm. And it takes a little while to get comfortable in your own skin there to say, it's okay. You know, I'm not going to know everything, and you might be better at something else. And, you know, that's great. This is how we're going to be a really good team. Super important points.
I totally agree. And the other thing to kind of take that whole, you know, years ago, a couple of points. It used to be, you know, let's focus on your weaknesses to get them stronger. Well, it's a weakness of mine for a reason. It's something that I'm just not, like, I'm not built to do, whatever the thing is. And right. to your point, when you give that then to someone else on your team or someone else, you know, in your sphere of influence, whatever that is, that's also a retention thing, because they feel valued. You've acknowledged their skills. You're giving them things that they like to do that perhaps challenge them a little bit more. In this day and age, retention is enormous, because if you can do some things that cost you really nothing and give them projects that they're good at, maybe it's even outside the you know, the lane of what they do, but that helps them be connected to here and say, yeah, you know what? They acknowledge these skills. They're going to let me keep doing these things in addition to everything else that I do. That is a retention thing. And like I said, it costs you nothing but time to give it to this person, train them up, coach them up. And you've got someone who, instead of maybe leaving after a year, maybe they will leave eventually, but maybe it'll be 3 or 5 years later.
Yeah.
And you've given, I think that's them a win for everybody.
Yeah. And you've given them some things to put in their toolbox that they can take along with them. These are transferable skills. They felt like their time here was well spent, and they come away still feeling very good about the time that they spent with that company, however long that might be.
Right.
Switching lanes here a little bit, we've talked a lot about how this leadership influence affects business. Let's take that over to the other side of volunteer. Volunteerism is very different because you don't have the position that we've kind of talked a little bit about, and your ability to influence on that lowest level really is based upon position. But when you get into an environment where you are a volunteer or a board member or something of that nature, you no longer have that position to lean on, and that changes your influence a little bit. You and I are both spend a lot of time volunteering in different things in our lives. We've both had that experience. Share a little bit about your experience as leadership in a volunteer setting.
Yeah, that's been really interesting. And I think that the first thing that comes to mind, like you said, you know, you and I both serve on a couple of boards, and I've just recently started getting more involved with our local food pantry. And I think it's, first of all, they have to see your commitment, your heart in doing what you're involved with. And it's not that, hey, I'm just here to add a line to my resume, not here to add a line to my LinkedIn profile. Yeah, those are all great things and they'll come later. But they have to understand and see your dedication to this mission, whatever that volunteer is. And then you have to have value that you bring and that you add, whether it's your time or your skills or both. That then lends itself to the influence at the volunteer point. They don't care about my title here at Tricom. They care about what time I'm willing to put in and help them reach their goals and their mission. Mm-hmm. It is absolutely zero to do with me. I am just part of the vehicle that's going to help them get there. So that's the big difference that I see.
I would agree with that. I think that they have to believe in you and your vision and what you want to do to help whatever volunteer organization that you're doing. Mm-hmm. And if you're able to get them to follow you and participate in the things that provide value to the organization because they believe in you, they trust you, they want to follow the direction that you're taking. Mm-hmm. They're doing it because they want to, because you care, mm-hmm. and because it is about the organization, not you, which is different in some cases where in a position, you may have a little bit of leverage on them. So right. uses the term leverage, and right. you do. Sometimes people follow you because they have leverage over you, even if mm-hmm. they're not necessarily pulling their leverage, you feel that you've got to follow them to some degree because they have the authority, the responsibility, whatever it might right. be, and you don't have that in volunteers. So, you know, in order for a board to work good together, you've got to be able to work together and have that influence at a higher level of leadership than you might maybe at level one in a business organization.
Right, right. Yeah, I agree. I absolutely agree. And I think, you know, the benefit that you and I have here that we have been able to take with us into our community volunteerism efforts is that we understand we have to meet them where they are and understand what their goals are and then say, here's my background and experience and here's how that's going to help you get there. Mm-hmm. And that is, certainly they look at your background and your experience and your willingness to spend time. But then when you can marry that with, let me help you get where you want to go, I think that that's what finally gets the credibility and the influence, because then they're like, okay, great. We're in this together. You're going to help us get there. Okay.
Yeah. We're all in. You feed off your passion, right?
Yeah.
Passion is key. If you, mm-hmm. if your heart isn't in it and you're not passionate about what you're doing, you know, in a volunteer situation, you don't have to spend the time and effort right. on it. You right. do it because you have passion and you want to, and, yep. and people feed off of that energy.
Yep.
And I think it's important to try and take that passion back to the office too.
Right.
Because you know how powerful it is in a volunteer organization to try and bring that passion, you know, every day to work.
Right. It's hard. It is really hard. Yeah.
It can be powerful, right?
Yeah, it is. Absolutely. I totally agree. So, yeah, I mean, and it's just a matter of, you know, sometimes you kind of have to remind yourself of when I'm coming in here. I mean, you know, people will say, like, you've been there so long, you know, what is it that you love about what you do? And for me, it's multiple things. And it really is, first of all, the influence that I get to have on the people that work with me. And when I get to see them reaching goals and I see that pride and that development and how they, you know, kind of move from I'm new in the company to now I've been here several months to now I've been here several years. And I get to watch that momentum and that development and that story. That's really fulfilling for me. And it's very selfish on my part, because that's why, one of the reasons why I love being in this role, because it is so fulfilling for me. And then obviously being able to work with clients and help them reach their goals. Obviously, it's a completely different set of goals than what the people that are on my team. But nonetheless, you get that sense of pride and fulfillment of, yeah, I helped guide them to that decision. I know what that's going to mean for their business. So, yeah, I really feel like you have to remember those things every day when you come in to, like you said, bring your passion of mm-hmm. what's my sphere of influence.
That's right. That's our pep in our step every day. That's what keeps
yeah,
us all going.
Exactly. Yep.
You know,
exactly.
They mentioned the a proverb, which I thought was interesting. So I want to share that. And I know we're getting long on time here, so we'll wrap up here.
Sure.
The proverb I thought was very interesting. It says, "He who leads but has no followers is only taking a walk."
I loved that. I laughed out loud when I read that, because I thought, oh my gosh, that is so true. It is so true. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, I loved it. So what was it that resonated with you about that? Why did you like it so much?
I liked it because I think it's so true. If you think that you're leading people, but they're really not following you, you can try to lead all you want. But if they don't want to follow you and they're not following you, you are literally all on your own. You're just taking a walk by yourself.
Yep.
You're not leading because nobody's following. So you have to kind of reflect on why are people not following, right? What are you missing in that formula to make people want to do it? Because you can't make people do it. No one will follow you.
Yeah,
because they are required to. They do so on their own accord because they want to. They value what you bring to the organization, how you help them grow and learn. Those are things that will help people, you know, get to that leadership role and actually have someone following.
I did. I totally loved that. And I just thought it was inspirational. It was eye-opening. And I know you and I do a lot of reading and a lot of soul searching. And that's one of the things that I always have to think about is, you know, we're involved in mentorship programs and, like we said, volunteer and everything else. And at the end of the day, I always do want to take a step back and say, is there something that I can improve on? I'm not looking at anything as a weakness. It's just from a communication standpoint, from a collaboration standpoint, all of those characteristics that make you more open and easy to communicate and follow that sometimes I fall down and I'm not where I want to be. And it's hard to take a step back and look at that. But, you know, as we've talked, I know we're running out of time here, but I'm hoping that when everybody listens to this, that they understand this massive impact that this little bitty 108-page book has. Mm-hmm. A lot of thought went into this. I just so respect how he wrote this. And every time I reread this and go back through my notes, there's another aha moment. So I can't speak highly enough about it. And I'm excited about our next session to kind of wrap up some more of these discussion points.
Right. To dive into more topics because they are wonderful. So Shelly, thank you for joining me today on this session of the Unleashed podcast series and talking about why influence is important. We hope you'll join us on our next session. Have a great day, everyone.
Good to see you, Amanda.